Last year, I graduated from China's most prestigious university, Qinghua University, with a master's in global business journalism. Qinghua is renowned for its beautiful campus, prestigious academics, and long list of celebrity alumni, such as China's presidents and top politicians. But my personal journey into one of the world's largest and most dynamic cities had humble beginnings, and started right here in the heart of the Eastern Cape, South Africa, at the Rhodes University Confucius Institute.
I think the Confucius Institute at Rhodes University is unusual in that it's fully integrated in its environment. As you know, Grahamstown and Rhodes University are not particularly Chinese places. We don't even have a good Chinese restaurant in town. So we decided right from the start to be involved, and we decided not to be a kind of extramural cultural club, but to develop a serious academic major in Chinese studies.
南非罗德斯大学孔子学院是根据2007年罗德斯大学跟孔子学院总部签署的协议而设立的。 2008年8月 罗德斯大学跟中国暨南大学签署了补充协议 10月份正式挂牌运作 2009年 罗德斯大学孔子学院在学术层面上以罗德斯大学语言学院中文部的名义开始正式运作。
We're very proud to be associated with the Chinese Hanban and the Confucius Institute family. We are strong supporters as the senior leadership of the university of the Confucius Institute. We think there are a number of reasons why it's well located at a university like Rhodes. Well, firstly, we are a highly international university. We have students from 66 countries around the world at Rhodes. 20% of our students are international students from all over the world. And secondly, we are a largely humanities university. And so Mandarin as a language of study and Chinese studies more generally fits in very well with the character of this university. As far as the location as an academic discipline of Mandarin is concerned, it's located in our School of Languages and it's an outstanding school. Mandarin takes its place alongside obviously English, but also indigenous language like isiXhosa, and German and French. And so the partnership of Hanban has really made it very much possible for us to offer Mandarin. And we think we serve our students wonderfully to the extent that our students must not just be professionals, but must also be able to navigate the country that they live in, the Africa they live in, and the world that they live in. We speak about the 21st century being the African century, and the century in which China really starts to take its role in the world. And so those who are going to be doing Mandarin at Rhodes, those who are going to be exposed to Chinese studies at the postgraduate level in time to come, we think we will be developing graduates that are going to be able to take their place in this new 21st century.
可以进来吗?
2009年新学年伊始, 罗德斯大学孔子学院以语言学院中文部的名义开设了中国研究汉语学分课程。这是罗德斯大学100多年历史以来第一次开设汉语课程。经过3年的努力，通过了审核和批准。 2001年，中国研究课程正式成为罗德斯大学一个新的主修专业课程。A
primary feature of the Confucius Institute at Rhodes University is a very strong relationship with Jinan University, and that manifests itself in a number of ways. The most obvious way, of course, is that the head of our Chinese studies program is headed by a seconded professor from Jinan University. But there are many other people that go backwards and forwards, and the relationship has built up over a number of disciplines, which span now, I think, primarily the humanities. We have a very strong program with the politics department, cross-teaching our staff going there, their staff coming here. We have student exchanges in areas like journalism, and we've also had exchanges of staff in fine art, and I think a number of other areas of the university. So that relationship has been very rich for us.
作为教学质量的监督标准，罗斯大学孔子学院自2010年起经过国家汉办批准，成立了汉语考试中心，引进了HSK作为教学质量监督的标准。在中学教学中，我们也引进了YCT作为外部质量监督标准。近年来，我们开设了HSK从二级到五级的考试。 HSKK、中级和高级的考试，以及YCT各个级别的考试，虽然学生是自愿参加这些考试，但是从几年来的情况看，参加考试的大部分的同学都以较好的成绩通过了考试，这说明我们的教学质量是达到了我们课程设置预期的标准。
One of the areas where we get particular support from Jinan University is in our China Week, where we have had visitors from Jinan University every year doing things like calligraphy displays, lectures on alternative medicine, lectures on China in Africa, Africa in China issues. That's been one of our major themes, China in Africa, Africa in China. Which was launched really with a fairly landmark conference in 2012, which took place in South Africa, and there'll be a follow-up conference in mainland China, in Beijing, later this year in November
2014. 然后其他的呢是他们在中国。
The other aspect is the community. We have two projects going there. The one is with two affluent schools, private schools in Grahamstown, DSG and St. Andrews. And we've been offering courses at grade 8 and grade 9 level there. It's been very successful and it's growing.
从2011年开始，学校DSG和圣特安德鲁两所中学正式把汉语作为第二外语选修课纳入学校课程。作为正式的语言课，每周四节课，这样一来我们就可以按照语言课正式来教汉语。从基本的汉拼音到汉字，从基本的对话到比较复杂的情景对话。 半年，课程结束的时候，一般学生都能够用汉语完成一些基本的对话，同时能对汉语和中国文化有一定的了解。不过，因为现在在南非汉语还不是高考课程，所以受到一定的限制，学生只能选修汉语学一年。但是从2014年，也就今年开始。 学生可以从八年级开始学两年。对于所有选修汉语的学生来说，他们必须要参加YCT考试。一般来说，通过学半年汉语，90%以上的学生能够通过YCT一级考试。比如说，去年有83个学生参加YCT考试。 其中有79个通过YCT考试。其实在最开始我们在DSG和圣特安德鲁的课程开始源于Chinese Club， 中文俱乐部每周一节课，我们主要除了一些最基本的对话外，主要是教中国的文化、中国的基本概况，另外还有一些课外活动，比如说学中国话、兼职做中国菜等等。现在除了 DSG 和圣特安德鲁之外，在Grahamstown的其他的一些学校，我们也给他们提供相应的中文俱乐部。
Okay, we can see that again.
Total opposite is our involvement in Upstart. Upstart is a local NGO focusing on literacy, and they have as members young people from very disadvantaged backgrounds. Our Chinese Studies 2 students have, as part of their academic work, they need to present a project, a term-long project, once a year to members of Upstart on Chinese themes. So we're very proud of our involvement in Upstart.
We are Upstart Youth Development Project, and we're based in Jozah location in Grahamstown in the Eastern Cape. For the past 3 years, we've been working with the Confucius Institute at Rhodes University, where our young learners who are at high school interact with second year Chinese studies students. And what we do is we share the different cultures, but we especially learn about Chinese, ancient Chinese culture through the use of folklore and storytelling. And so this is a group of school learners who have been part of the last 2 years' interactions with the Confucius Institute.
2012年, 罗斯大学孔子学院, 中国文化中心, 在社区正式挂牌, 融中文图书馆, 和中国文化活动专用场地为一体, 成为面向社区开展中国文化活动的一个新的窗口。 中国文化中心的设立得到了中国驻南非大使田学金和中国驻西开府总领馆梁树根总领事和李立贝副总领事的热情的关心和支持。
There are a number of other activities that supplement the Chinese experience in Rhodes, two of which are calligraphy and Chinese tea culture. In calligraphy, students are not only afforded the opportunity to appreciate the works of some of China's greatest calligraphy masters, such as Wang Shizhi, but we get to try our hand at our own calligraphy too. In Chinese tea culture, we learn that the differences between Chinese tea and Western tea are quite vast. 这个杯子为什么这么小? 你说味道是最重要的吗? 那牛奶和糖呢? 什么? 没有牛奶和糖? 哇! What we discovered is tea in the West and tea in China are vastly different. But by far, one of the most interesting activities has to be that of the Chinese Bridge Competition. The Chinese Bridge is an international proficiency competition held for non-Chinese students around the world. Confucius Institutes from around the world in each different country hold their own version of the Chinese Bridge Competition, where students are asked to showcase their abilities in speaking and performing Chinese culture. The winners of each competition then congregate in China once a year to compete in the international version of the competition. In 2010, Rhodes University and the Confucius Institute here had the opportunity to host the second Chinese Bridge Competition. And in 2011, in UCT, we walked away again with first prize. Another spin-off from the Chinese Bridge Competition, which is a great opportunity to all our students, was the opportunity to travel to China on a summer camp. 20 of our top students were selected, specifically those that participated in the Chinese Bridge Competition, and enjoyed a full-month tour of China. Starting in Guangzhou, we traveled north to the capital, Beijing, and witnessed wonders such as the Great Wall of China, Tiananmen Square, and the Forbidden City, until traveling down again back to Guangzhou and eventually leaving from Hong Kong.
I was very lucky to have spent a year in China, 2005-2006 at Zhejiang University, teaching English and getting a bit closer to Chinese literature, hearing it in original. It was great.
And I understand there's some form of collaboration between the Confucius Institute and the School of Languages, is that right?
We did a very interesting experiment. We took a poem by Du Fu, a very famous classical poem, and the professor here, Prof. Ma, translated it into very plain prose, and then we had a little seminar with all the languages spoken in the language school of languages, from Latin to Xhosa to Afrikaans, and everybody made their own poem in their own language of a Du Fu poem. In the following year, we did a sort of similar thing, but not a translation. We took a famous Chinese story called Sai Wang Loses His Horse, and we asked people to write a story with the same philosophical underpinnings, also in their own languages, and write a little essay about it. But the point is, people engaged with texts, you know, they weren't just chatting about Chinese culture in general.
Rob, do you anticipate any future engagement with the Confucius Institute?
We'll find other ways. We could do something with painting. We could, you know, we could do another kind of literary endeavor. I think we should, because it really makes you, it makes the students look very closely. And one's not talking in general terms at a specific thing. So I'd like to carry on.
In 2011, the year I left for China, I had already studied 3 years with the Confucius Institute. I had engaged with the language, learnt the culture, and participated in a number of activities. With HSK level 4, and having placed high in the local Chinese bridge competitions, entry into Tsinghua University was an easy affair. On top of that, I also received a full scholarship covering all my expenses for the next 2 years. As I landed in Beijing, immediately, the value of my education at the Confucius Institute became apparent. No one spoke English. A typical example would go something like this. 外国人, 你是从哪儿来的? 我是南非的。 南非? 那不是非洲的吗? 是啊。 那你不会吧? 为什么不会? 你不是黑人。 These kinds of interactions would soon become daily occurrences. So, armed with a newfound sense of the Chinese language and a small understanding of the culture, I would embark on what was to become the journey of a lifetime.